You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, everyone. We are now going to talk about late medieval Italy from the years 1200 to 1400. Our topic right now, the first topic for the course, is late medieval Italy, 1200 to 1400. And I want to alert you that you may also use the term Middle Ages when speaking about the medieval period. But it's preferable to say medieval and not really medieval, for the obvious reason it's not an evil period, because art historians put the label Middle Ages on this time using 2020 hindsight and saying, well, that's the middle period before the Renaissance, which we know is true. But at the time, nobody knew that because no one knew the future in 1200, right? So I think medieval is a better term, but that's kind of a small point. But I just want you to know, don't get confused. Middle Ages, medieval, same thing. Okay, so I want to start out always with questions, and I hope you're jotting down questions to pop in our questions discussion link on Blackboard. These three questions are fundamental to this period of 1200 to 1400. Are the years 1200 to 1400 the last phase of medieval art? Or, point two, are the years 1200 to 1400 the beginning of the Renaissance? Or number three, do the years 1200 to 1400 reflect both arguments? And if so, how? As you work through this week's material, I really want you to think about all of those arguments. And I believe number three, the idea that 1200 to 1400 is never going to be a perfect, the Renaissance starts here, the medieval ends here. I think number three has a lot of weight behind it. I just want you to start looking at art to figure out why these questions came about. What do you see that's medieval looking? What do you see that's starting to look like the Renaissance? Okay. Now, let's talk about the term Renaissance, pronounced Renaissance by some scholars. We'll go with the American accent, Renaissance. The Renaissance, that term means rebirth. Any of you who know French or Spanish can see it in the word Renaissance. Rebirth and naissance, something about birth. Rebirth. And from the 13th century through the 16th century, i.e., 1200 to about 1500, there was this incredible rebirth of the values of ancient Rome and Greece, in Italy in particular. And among these ideas, we have a delight in naturalism, or depicting subjects in what you would call realistic detail. Now think about something. During the medieval period, the depictions of the spiritual world, think about gargoyles, demons, dragons, things you probably love about that period. Those depictions of the spiritual world were very important. Naturalism, doing a portrait that looked realistic, wasn't as important, but never think that it was impossible for a medieval artist to make a naturalistic portrait or landscape. Think about the choice here. And in the medieval period, there was so much influence of religion that portraying that imaginative religious world was a strong motivation. During the Renaissance, religion is still important, but the individual becomes important, therefore naturalism. Also, please remember that during the Renaissance, the Italians lived among the ruins of ancient Rome. What we think of, if we were to go and look at the Colosseum and say, oh, look at the ruins of the Colosseum, that was also a ruin for the people who lived during the Renaissance, and they were intrigued, as you and I are, about those ruins. And another point, the Renaissance is not just in Italy. It also occurs in what we call Northern Europe. That would be Germany today, Netherlands. And so the Italians do not have a hold on, they're not the only ones involved in a Renaissance, but they certainly come out of the gate running. And in the north, the art will look different, the Northern Renaissance art. And I think you're going to be really, I hope you're really interested in the differences. Let's situate ourselves quickly with a map to understand that Italy, as you're seeing here, during this period, 1200 to 1400, was an assortment of city-states. This map has a flaw, which is it shows Switzerland at the top. It shows the Ottoman Empire. This map is giving you some more modern, for the time, markers. Please just focus on the boot. You know, Italy, the boot, kicking the soccer ball of the Kingdom of Sicily. And if you look at these different colored sections, you see the kingdom of Naples in the south. You see the Kingdom of Sicily. Oh, did you know there were kings in Italy during this time? Yes, there were. But there was not one central king who had control over Italy. I see the Republic of Florence and the Republic of Siena, the Papal State, the Republic of Venice, the Duchy, am I saying that? There was a Duke of Milan, there was a Duke of Savoy. And this tells you something. Italy had a lot of different forms of government at this time. There were kings, there were dukes, there were some sort of republics, like more, you would say, democratic, and they were all different. And this is going to affect the art dramatically, dramatically. Let's look at a few examples to get into this question about what are we talking about in the period? Late medieval, early Renaissance, and we must start with Giotto. You will notice that the artists' names from the Renaissance usually turn into a nickname of sorts. So Giotto di Bondone went by Giotto. He became so famous, you know, just went by Giotto. Sometimes the artists go by the town in which they were born. That becomes their name or their last name, etc. What you're looking at here is considered to be one of the best, and I use that word with a big scare quote, you know, best is a judgment, examples of a fresco from this early period. And many people call Giotto the first Renaissance painter. So the fresco comes from the Arena Chapel in Padua, Italy. And in your materials for week one, I have an additional link for you to watch that gives you much more context of what this chapel looked like. I know you're going to like it. The patron here, Enrico Scrivegni, was a wealthy man, and he built this chapel near his lovely palace to atone for a sin. And his sin was that he charged interest on loans to people. That's called usury. And so we have a patron who's not a religious man. We have a patron who's really a businessman. Questions you need to think about when looking at the panels, in the fresco panels. What techniques are used by Giotto to make things look more naturalistic? And let's pull out a detail here, the lamentation over Christ's body. And I will leave some of this work up to you, but I would like to point out that compared to some of the flatness of medieval art, there are some attempts, for example, the stone wall, to divide the space and give a greater sense of depth in the fresco. People are shown in front of each other, behind each other. At least one figure on the lower left is not even facing us. These are techniques to give a sense of space. And this is very important in getting toward a more naturalistic scene. But there's still elements of the non-visible world. There are angels. These are still religious figures with halos, etc. And yet there's still an attempt maybe to show a little bit of individual quality in the faces and the hairstyles, trying to make things look a little bit more natural. Now, I've noted on this slide some terms that have to do with the making of a fresco. And a fresco means fresh in Italian. A fresco is created when you place pigments on either a wet plaster, buon fresco, or a dry plaster, a secco fresco. And Giornata is of great interest in this particular detail. Would you look at the sky for a moment, and do you see the different tones of blue? In a way, that's a mistake, because Giornata means a day's work in Italian. When artists worked on frescoes that were wet, this was a wet fresco, they had only the light of day to finish a section, right? They don't have electric lights in these chapels to work by. So look at one of the dark blue sections. When the artist came back the next morning, you can see where the artist and his assistants went and started a new section because the blue dried in a different tone of blue. And that helps us know how many days it took to do the sky, because we can see that the colors dried differently. Now, what you saw in that, all of those frescoes that create the chapel, and what you'll learn about more after you watch the additional material for the week in the week one folder, is that a cycle of Christ's life was portrayed. And that's very important. You'll read about that in your textbook too, that there are certain scenes, Christ's birth, Christ's death, Christ's on the cross. And that is called a cycle when the artist would show the whole cycle, as Giotto did in the chapel frescoes. So that's like a storyboard, everybody. That's like a storyboard of our time. Okay, let's move to Nicola Pisano and this wonderful pulpit for a baptistry on the left. And that is created from marble. That's all carved marble. Would you look at the columns, please, and note these different colors of marble? You might enjoy going up to the Getty Villa if you already haven't gone and seen the marble room. It is the Romans who loved the different marble colors. Even there's a purple color they love. There's like a greenish color, a gold color. And when I look at the baptistry, I'm reminded of the medieval influence. Can you see it as well? You can certainly see archways with three small lobes over those columns, trefoils. That's very medieval. Would you look at the lions? The columns are setting on the, or resting on these great lions with lots of fur. Those are medieval beasts. So you can see that medieval story of the arts coming back in. And if you find this work really crowded, I am agreeing with you, because the Romans, now we're seeing an ancient reference, the Romans loved to crowd things and have small scenes jammed up with people. One of the references for this work is a sarcophagus, which you see on the right. That's a Roman sarcophagus where you can see the gods and goddesses and this intricate, very busy carving. So Pisano, working in 1259, he was bringing in ideas from ancient Rome, and he was also bringing in medieval ideas. One individual, King Frederick II of Sicily, at this time, the King of Sicily, really liked Rome and had a strong nostalgia for Rome, and he commissioned a lot of works, such as this. I have a photo here of the two popes as we speak in 2020. Both, we have two popes, although Benedict is a retired pope. Francis and Benedict, this is a rare occurrence in the history of the Vatican. However, in 1305, this situation came up where there was an argument. French Pope Clement V was elected, but he lived in France, and the people in Rome did not like that. So at that time, you see the rise of other religious figures to sort of fill the vacuum because the Pope is in France, Avignon, France. And you need to know this for this course, because the Franciscans and the Dominicans really got control, or had a lot of power when the Pope was living in France. And they commissioned a lot of artworks, very important. In addition, this group called the Confraternity, this would be a group of lay people who could perform certain rites of the Catholic Church, they also got some authority and became popular, and they also commissioned art. So we first have a pope in France instead of Italy. Then the Great Schism of 1378, we actually have two popes elected. That is the other time in history when we had two popes. Now Pope Benedict, he's retired. He doesn't interfere. In 1378, those popes were both fighting for authority. One lived in France, Clement VII, and Urban VI lived in Rome. It took 40 years to fix this problem and return to just having one pope. I want you to be aware of this part of the story, because in this story we have other groups, as I mentioned, coming to power and commissioning art. We will move to, this artist's name is properly pronounced Chimabu, or Chimabue. It means bull's head. I don't know what he looked like. Perhaps he had a head shaped like a bull. I don't know, but Chimabue is the last artist we'll talk about in this section. And this is a very, very famous depiction of the Madonna, or the Virgin Mary, enthroned. She is sitting on a throne. I hope you see that. This is not so commonly depicted today, but there was a time when she was always shown on a throne in heaven. And she's holding the Christ child. She has a halo, and she's surrounded by angels and prophets. Would you look at the angel's wings? They're very beautifully done with all these modulations of color like feathers. It's really pretty extraordinary. Now, this painting has a lot of gold. Gold leaf is when you take thinned out gold and you apply it to wood. That's a throwback to an early Christian period. And yet he's given much more space. Again, look at how figures stand in front of one another or behind one another. And that's a hallmark of a more Renaissance style. Their bodies aren't as rigid as you might have seen in the past. There might be some emotion on her face. That's going to really pick up in the Renaissance to make people look more, make even religious figures look more like people. There is a reference for her, Chimabue, and this is a very famous mosaic from the 9th century in Istanbul at the Hagia Sophia called the Theotokos, or the Mother of God mosaic. And if you would just let your eyes linger on both, I think you see similar cloak, a throne, but she's sitting on more of a table-like throne. And it's definitely a story between the early Renaissance artist and the predecessor, who made a mosaic, by the way. So on your right, that's composed of individual tiles and jewels. Can you imagine doing that kind of work? Her body on the right in the mosaic does have some flexibility, but look what Chimabue accomplishes by using tempera paint and the folds between her knees, and it's just a little bit of a more relaxed pose. So that's where we're getting into our early Renaissance ideas. Let's stop with this and think about my question, please. Where are you seeing medieval influence? Where are you seeing some new ideas, Renaissance kind of ideas, in these works that we just talked about?
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.